Go with me, if you will, to 1 Samuel chapter 12. 1 Samuel chapter 12. To give you a little backstory on 1 Samuel chapter 12, we need to go to 1 Samuel chapter 8, but I'll do that for you. What's happening in 1 Samuel 12 is Samuel has been serving as judge over the people of Israel. And he has served since his youth. He has served since a boy. He was raised in the temple under the priest Eli and was brought up as a priest and has served as priest and as judge over Israel for his entire life, practically. And so in chapter 8, verse 4, then all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah and said to him, "Behold, you are old, and your sons do not walk in your ways. Now appoint for us a king to judge us like all the nations." So Samuel is in the later years of his life. He's coming to the end of his life. And the people of Israel come to him and say, "We're tired of you being our judge. We don't want your sons to be our judges. So make us like all the other nations around us and give us a king." And so this is something that has hurt Samuel's feelings, obviously, because as we're going to see later, it's not Samuel that the Israelites have turned their backs on. It's not Samuel that the Israelites are rejecting. We're going to see later that it's God that the Israelites have turned their backs on. But in chapter 12, Samuel is now saying he's delivering his farewell address as he steps down from being judge over Israel. He is now anointed Saul as king. Saul has assumed his role as king over Israel, and Samuel is now offering his farewell address to the people. In the first five verses, Samuel does something interesting before he lays out to them what it is that he's about to say. Verses 1 through 5, "And Samuel said to all Israel, 'Behold, I have obeyed your voice in all that you have said to me, and have made a king over you. And now behold, the king walks before you, and I am old and gray. And behold, my sons are with you. I have walked before you from my youth until this day. Here I am, testify against me before the Lord and before his anointed. Whose ox have I taken, or whose donkey have I taken? Or whom have I defrauded? Whom have I oppressed? Or from whose hand have I taken a bribe to blind my eyes with it? Testify against me, and I will restore it to you.' They said, 'You have not defrauded us or oppressed us, or taken anything from any man's hand.' And he said to them, 'The Lord is witness against you, and his anointed is witness this day, that you have not found anything in my hand.' And they said, 'He is witness.'" What Samuel is doing here is he is making an appeal for credibility. Samuel is saying, "I have served you my entire life. What have I done as I offered to you my final instructions, as I offered to you my final address, maybe my final warnings? Before I speak, I'm going to give you an opportunity to tell me what it is that I have done, if anything, to lose my credibility before you. What have I done? Have I taken anything from you? Have I oppressed you in any way? Have I done anything against you that would discredit me in my position to offer you this farewell address?" And the Israelites say, "No." So you haven't done anything. There's nothing that you've done to us. You haven't oppressed us. You haven't taken anything from us to defraud you or to defraud us and discredit you. And so Samuel says, okay, he's given them an opportunity. Now it's time to lay down what it is that God has given him to say. I would ask us in this moment, right now, to understand the credibility, not of me. Not of me. I'm not a prophet. I'm not Samuel. I'm not asking for credibility for me. I want us to acknowledge the credibility of God's Word. Before we jump into this lesson today, understand that God's Word, according to Hebrews chapter 4, is living and active. It is sharper than any two-edged sword. It pierces to the division of soul and spirit, of bone and marrow, and it discerns the thoughts and intentions of the heart. God's Word is truth, and God's Word pierces us to our hearts. And sometimes what it is that God's Word is saying to us is hard for us to accept. And what Samuel is going to say to the Israelites here in 1 Samuel chapter 12 is hard to accept. And so before he starts off with an appeal to credibility. And so let's understand what it is that God's Word says to us and what God's and that God's Word stands as a credible source for our lives and for us to follow. Now, I'm not going to stand up here and try to preach at anybody. I'm not going to stand up here and try to insult anybody or call anybody out or make anybody feel guilty for anything. Please don't take anything that I say as me attacking anyone, because anything that I may say today, I'm just as guilty of as anyone else in this room. I stand before you as an imperfect man, someone who has made a lot of mistakes in my life, and I stand as someone who would never try to exalt myself over anyone. But God's Word is truth. God's Word cuts every one of us to the heart. And I hope that it does that. I hope that it does that for you. Maybe not today, but any time that you interact with the Word of God, I hope that it cuts you to the heart and it convinces you of its truth. So what Samuel does, after he's given them, after he's made an appeal for his credibility, this is what he says in verse 6. And Samuel said to the people, "The Lord is witness who appointed Moses and Aaron and brought your fathers up out of the land of Egypt. Now therefore stand still that I may plead with you before the Lord concerning all the righteous deeds of the Lord that he performed for you and for your fathers." Samuel says, he starts off his address by saying, "Stand still." I want you to mark that in your Bible. If you have it digitally, then highlight it on your app. Or if you have a pen, underline it. If you have a highlighter, highlight it. I want you to highlight, I want you to mark those two words in your Bible, "stand still." Because this is something that we have to do regularly. We need to stand still and reflect on the things that God has done. We need to, that song that we sing often, "Count Your Many Blessings," right? You can't count them if you're running. Okay, you can't count them if you're busy. You need to stand still and understand what it is that God has done for you. And Samuel's about to highlight some of the things that God has done for the Israelites. In verse 8, he says, "When Jacob went into Egypt and the Egyptians oppressed them, then your fathers cried out to the Lord, and the Lord sent Moses and Aaron, who brought your fathers out of Egypt and made them dwell in this place." Samuel says, I need you to remember. I want you to stand still, and I want you to remember what it is that God has done for you to bring you to this point, to bring you where you are today as a people and as individuals. Think about what God has done, and let's think right now some of the things that God did for the Israelites. First of all, God created the heavens and the earth, right? In His glorious power, He created the entire known universe. And then we think about things like the flood, how He saved Noah and his family through the flood. And then we think about the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And we think about the oppression, the slavery in Egypt. And that's where Samuel goes here, is the slavery in Egypt. And let's think about what happened in Egypt. Think about the 10 plagues. Think about when God led the Israelites out of Egypt and He led them to the Red Sea. He parted the Red Sea. They walked across on dry land. The 40 years they wandered in the wilderness, their clothes never wore out. Their shoes never wore out. He fed them manna and quail. They didn't have to go and provide any of their own food. Twice, God provided water from a rock. Now, I don't know how many of you have ever busted open a rock before, okay? But all the rocks that I've ever busted open in my lifetime, the only thing inside it is more rock. That's it. That's all that's inside a rock. But God made water come out of a rock. And He made enough water come out of a rock twice to quench the thirst of what is estimated to be about 1 million people. Not only 1 million people, but all of their livestock. That's a miraculous thing. We think about what God did at Mount Sinai when He handed down the law, when the cloud descended on Mount Sinai and it shook, and there was fire, and it was to the point that if the Israelites came up to it and they touched it, they would die because of the presence of God. We think about, Gary talked about a few weeks ago, about the city of Jericho. All the Israelites had to do with this impenetrable city was walk around it a few times, and God dropped the walls like that. They walked through the land of Canaan, and they conquered every people that they came across. And now they are standing in the land of Canaan, the land that God has given them, and they are demanding a king. And Samuel says, stand still and reflect on what God has done to bring you to this point. He says, I'm going to talk to you about your decision to set up a king here in a second. But first, I want you to understand what it is that God has done for you to bring you here. Right now in this moment, let's think about ourselves and what God has done for us to bring us here. Everyone in this room, you're sitting in the seat that you're in for a reason. I don't know what that reason is, and I don't know what it is that has brought you here, but whatever it is that God has done for you, He's been there. He's been there the entire time. And you're here for a reason. And He brought you here for a reason. For me, personally, the things that God has done for me, I was born to parents who made sure that God was number one in my life. When we were at home, we talked about Scripture. When we were at home, we prayed together. There was nothing that came in front of going to church or of serving God. My sisters and I played baseball, Little League baseball, when we were kids. Now, I was never very good, okay? I'm not going to talk about my sisters. You can ask them about if they were good or not. I was never very good, okay? I'm still not very good at it, okay? But I played Little League baseball, and I loved it. I enjoyed it. I enjoyed being on a team. I enjoyed playing sports. I enjoyed the few times that I got a hit and got to be on base. I never ran very fast, so I always got out. But the few times that I got on base, that was a big deal, okay? But every single coach that I ever had in sports understood that the Shrum kids were not going to be there on Sundays or Wednesdays. It wasn't going to happen. There was even a time where one of my coaches approached my parents and said, I'm pretty sure I know the answer to this, but I've got to ask it anyway. We're thinking about having practices on Wednesdays. And they just started shaking their heads. He didn't even finish. He just said, that's what I thought. And he walked away. I'm not saying that coming to church is the only thing that makes us faithful Christians, but it is one of the most important things. And my parents made sure that I understood that. And when I played football through middle school and high school, my coaches understood on Wednesdays, I don't care how long practice is going to run for everybody else. Kyle's leaving at 6:30 so he can be at church. And my mom pulled me off the field sometimes. She walked out there and pulled me off the field sometimes and took me to church. I'm not going to talk about how embarrassing that was, but anyway. God has been number one in my life from the get-go. God brought me to an incredible church family. Some of you were here when my family came here when I was 5 years old. Some of you were here. Some of you have come since then. But all of you have participated in bringing me up in the Lord and bringing my sisters up in the Lord. And now you're going to participate in bringing my own son up in the Lord. God gave me an incredible set of parents, an incredible family, an incredible church family. He gave me an incredible wife that helped keep me grounded when I was through college and I was making bad decisions and I was struggling with things and questions that I had, and she kept me grounded. And she keeps me grounded even today. Because sometimes my head gets big and it needs to be shrunk down a little bit. Those are just some of the things that God has done for me to bring me here today. What has God done for you to bring you here today? Because the Israelites needed to be reminded that God had done something for them to bring them to this point. They needed to be reminded what God had done and how active He had been in every moment of their life. And it's something we can't lose sight of either. I don't want to stand here and convict any of you of not doing this, because I forget, okay? And that's what happens, okay? Verse 9, Samuel says, after he talks about God brought your fathers out of the land of Egypt and He brought you to dwell in this place, he says, but they forgot the Lord their God. All those things that I just told you about from my life, sometimes I forget. I get to another point in my life where I don't remember those things. They get shoved in the background. Something else takes precedence. Something else diverts my attention, and I forget. And sometimes I get to a point where I do what the Israelites have done. And I set up another king in my life. I set up something else that's going to draw my attention away. Because that's exactly what the Israelites have done. He says, but they forgot the Lord their God. What happened when they forgot the Lord their God? And he sold them into the hand of Sisera, commander of the army of Hazor, and into the hand of the Philistines, and into the hand of the king of Moab, and they fought against them. Bad things happen when you forget the Lord your God. Bad things happen when you forget who it is that brought you to where you are. And that's what happened to the Israelites. When you read through the Old Testament, you read through all of the things that the Israelites went through. They go through these ups and downs and ups and downs. And he continues here and he says, and they cried out to the Lord and said, we have sinned because we have forsaken the Lord and have served the Baals and the Ashtaroth, but now deliver us out of the hand of our enemies that we may serve you. They would forget him and they would set up these other kings and they would set up these other gods and they would walk away from him, and then they would come to their senses and they would realize what it is that they have done. And they'd cry out to him. I do that. Do you do that? Do you know people who do that? They set up these other kings for themselves. And they may go through that for a little while. But then they come to their senses and they realize, I need God. I need God again. But here's the thing. What we read here in verse 11 is that it's not about us needing God again. It's about God never leaving. It's about God never being gone, right? It says in verse 11, and the Lord sent Jerubbaal and Barak and Jephthah and Samuel and delivered you out of the hand of your enemies on every side, and you lived in safety. God rescues us, doesn't he? When we realize what it is that we have done, when we come to him in repentance and we come to him crying out to him, what does he do? He sends us deliverance. What have you been delivered from? How many times have you been delivered? Because it's not about just once, right? It happens over and over and over again for many of us. You don't just get, you know, God didn't just send one judge. The book of Judges would be a lot shorter if he only had to send one judge. He didn't just send one. He sent a bunch over a long period of time. Because every time he delivered them, they forgot again. And then they had to cry out again, and then he had to deliver them again. And every time that he delivered them in a way that it was unmistakable, that it was him that did it. And they forgot again anyway. Does that happen to you? It happens to me. Why does it happen? Why do we forget? What are the things that we set up for ourselves, these other kings that we ask for and set up over our lives that make us forget? You think about that for yourself. Think about what it is that you set up. And when you saw that Nahash, verse 12, the king of the Ammonites came against you, you said to me, no, but a king shall reign over us. He said, it's not good enough anymore. It's not good enough that God has given us you, Samuel, or he has given us all these other judges. It's not good enough that he has delivered us in these miraculous ways, that he has run these other people out of the land of Canaan and given it to us. That's not enough. We want a king. Why do we want a king? Because we want to be like everybody else. Sometimes we feel the need to be like everybody else, don't we? Sometimes the pressure is just a little too much. We've got to succeed. We've got to be better. We have to have the notoriety and the respect. We have to do this and this and this so we can be like everybody else. And Samuel says, this is what they said to him. No, but a king shall reign over us so that we can be like everybody else. And Samuel says, when the Lord your God was your king. God is your king. He is our king. He was the Israelites' king, and he is our king today. But it doesn't matter, does it? Because sometimes we wind up setting up these other kings. We ask for these other kings. We ask for these other things that are going to define us and give us notoriety and make us like everybody else. Because for some reason, we want to be like everybody else. I don't know what that king is for you. I don't know if it's your job or your retirement plan or if it's sports or if it's education. I don't know if it's an addiction. I don't know what it is for you, okay? But whatever it is, it's another king. And I want you to understand something, okay? That king does not define you. That king did not make you. That king does not know the number of hairs on your head. That king does not set your value. And your one true king doesn't want you to be like everybody else, because if he wanted you to be like everybody else, he would have made you like everybody else. Because he made you. The psalmist says, "You stitched me together in my mother's womb. You know the number of the hairs on my head. You knew the days of my life before one of them came to be." If he wanted you to be like everybody else, he would have made you like everybody else. And if he wanted the Israelites to have been like everybody else, he would have made them like everybody else. He would have not gone through all of the things that he went through to bring them to where they were just so that they could be like everybody else. But what happened? He let them, didn't he? He let them. Because when you go back to 1 Samuel chapter 8, and they ask for a king, you go to verse 9. And this is the Lord speaking to Samuel. "Now then, obey their voice. Do what it is that they're asking. Set up a king for them." Because when you go back to Deuteronomy 17, you see that God says, he lays down for the people. He says, "When you forget me and you ask for a king, this is what the king is going to be held to. This is the standard the king is going to be held to." He made up laws for the king at the very beginning that they were going to ask for later because he knew that it was going to happen. And in 1 Samuel 8, he says, "Obey their voice, only you shall solemnly warn them and show them the ways of the king who shall reign over them." So this is what Samuel says. This is what's going to happen with the king that you set up over yourself. So Samuel told all the words of the Lord to the people who were asking for a king from him. He said, "This will be the ways of the king who you will reign over you. He will take your sons and appoint them to his chariots and to be his horsemen and to run before his chariots. And he will appoint for himself commanders of thousands and commanders of fifties and some to plow his ground and to reap his harvest and to make his implements of war and the equipment of his chariots. He will take your daughters to be perfumers and cooks and bakers. He will take the best of your fields and vineyards and olive orchards and give them to his servants. He will take the tenth of your grain and of your vineyards and give it to his officers and to his servants. He will take your male servants and female servants and the best of your young men and your donkeys and put them to his work. He will take the tenth of your flocks and you shall be his slaves." Samuel tells them, in chapter 8, when they're asking for a king, "God has told me to set up a king for you, but this is what's going to happen. You will be his slaves." And when you become a slave of a false king, of an empty king, a king that cannot deliver you, what happens to you? You become his slave. And this is what you become focused on. Your sons and your daughters are not going to be concerned with the work of God, of honoring God, of doing what it is that God has for them to do. They're going to be concerned with what the king has for them to do. They're going to be soldiers now. They're going to be bakers and cooks for his people now. They're going to work in his palace and do what he tells them to do. He's going to come and he's going to reap the benefits of your work. He's going to come into your fields and take the tenth that you're supposed to be given to me, God, the tenth that you're supposed to be giving to me, he's going to take it and he's going to use it the way he sees fit. He's going to take from your olive presses. He's going to take from your vineyards and your fields. He's going to do with your stuff what he wants to do. You will be his slaves. And your children will be his slaves. And there's nothing that you can do about it. Does that sound like you? Have you experienced that? Have you experienced being a slave of a false king? Because let me tell you something, these other kings that we set up for ourselves are false. That's the only thing they can be. You see, Jesus is God, okay? We understand from the New Testament, from the entire book of John, everything you read in the Gospels points to Jesus being God, okay? The Word was with God in the beginning, the Word was God. We understand from the book of Matthew, chapter 25, that Jesus is the King. Jesus is the King who will sit on his throne and judge us for the things that we have done. The end of Matthew 28, it says, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Jesus is our King. Jesus is the King who is going to be judging us. And three times in the New Testament, once in 1 Timothy chapter 6, and twice in the book of Revelation, chapter 17 and chapter 19, Jesus is called the King of Kings. The King of Kings. Okay? When you read that in your Bible, you notice that the singular king is capitalized and the plural king is lowercase. Okay? Of Kings is in a possessive case, for those of you grammar nerds out there. It's in a possessive case, which means that these kings, these lowercase kings, belong to the uppercase king. The authority and the power of this king, this singular king, encompasses all of the authority and the power of the lowercase kings. You see what that means? It doesn't matter how many other kings we serve in our time. There's only one king whose service is going to count. These kings wouldn't even be here without the king. Three times he is called the King of Kings, and he is the king who will rule over you and will judge you on the last day. And that's what Samuel is trying to get the Israelites to understand. You already had a king. The Lord was your king. But now you've set up this false one. This is what's going to happen to you. It's a warning to us as well. It's a warning to us. What happens here? Let's talk about, we talked about earlier what it was that God has done for us as our King. There's something else that we need to understand about what God has done for us as our King, what Jesus has done for us as our King. Okay? Philippians chapter 2 tells us what it is that Jesus did as our King. Kings didn't do this, by the way. What I'm about to describe to you is not normal behavior for a king. Okay? You don't see, when you go through history, you don't see kings doing this kind of stuff that Jesus did for their servants. Okay? Kings don't do this. Okay? What Jesus did was he stepped down from his throne in heaven. He was equal to God, but did not count equality with God something to be grasped. He gave up his position as king in heaven, and he came down here and was born as a man. And he walked this earth as a man for 30-something years. And he faced every temptation we face, according to Hebrews. He faced every temptation he faced. He faced temptation from the devil himself. Stood in the wilderness against the devil himself and faced temptation. He went through everything that we experience, and yet without sin. And while he was here, he served. While he was here, he loved. While he was here, he showed people a different way, a better way. And ultimately, what he did as our king is he allowed mortal men to falsely convict him of something that he did not do, to beat him, to publicly shame him, to rip his body to pieces, and to nail him to a cross until he died, publicly, embarrassingly, in front of everybody. They put him next to a road so that people could see what it was that happened to people who went against Rome. They put him on a road so that people could see what was happening to this king of the Jews. He did that for you. And then he rose again on the third day and conquered death for you so that he could be with you. Kings don't do that. Kings don't do that. There's only been one king to ever do that, and that's Jesus. And he's the only one that could do that. And what does Samuel say here? What does Samuel say? He talks about how these false kings cannot deliver and it cannot save because they are empty. Paul tells us the same thing in the New Testament. He tells us all of these things that we chase. He talks about in Philippians chapter 3 how their God is their belly, their end is destruction. Because they serve these other kings. And Samuel says at the end of his address, "But if you still do wickedly, you shall be swept away, both you and your king." Jesus stepped down from heaven and died on a cross as your king so that he could be with you. These other kings that you set up for yourself will not do that and cannot do that. They cannot save you. They cannot deliver you. They are empty and they are false, and their way is destruction. That's what God's word says. Now, I didn't want to convict anyone in here. I didn't want to stand here and pass judgment on you because I do the exact same thing. But we have to understand that these other things that we follow, these other things that we set up for ourselves, these other things that we serve cannot save us. Solomon, who was a king, by the way, Solomon in Ecclesiastes tells us what it is that we need to know. As if this wasn't enough. Solomon was the wisest king to ever live. He had all knowledge that any man could ever possess. He had all riches that any man could possess. He pursued every avenue of education, every avenue of pleasure. He had women. He had food. He had animals. He had servants. He had palaces. He had everything that any man could ever imagine. And at the end of it, what he said was this: "I have pursued everything. This is the end of the matter." After calling all of those things vain, vanity of vanities, a chasing after the wind, he said, "This is the end of the matter. Fear God and keep His commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. The only thing that saves you is serving your king, the king, the king of kings, no other kings." Which king are you serving? Who is your king? If he is your king and you serve him as your king, what about the people around you who are not serving him as their king? Because even if they don't acknowledge it, even if they don't understand it, even if they don't know it, Jesus is their king too. You know, it's not about whether we know, you know, somebody knows that Jesus is their king or not. Jesus is their king whether they know it or not. And if you're serving him, and if you know that he is your king, you need to tell them that he is their king too. Because that's our service. I want to ask you today, put away your kings because they are false and they are empty. Don't serve them anymore. It doesn't matter what it is, who it is, how long you've been serving them. Put them away. Get rid of them. Because there is only one service. There is only one king who matters. And he is your king. And he made you so that you could serve him. And he came here so that he could be with you. If you have never put Jesus on in baptism, if you have never accepted him as your Savior and as your king, do it today. Because he is your king. And he's the only one who can judge you, and he's the only one who can save you. If you've been saved by him before, But you've set up other kings for yourself, and you're following after those kings. Stop today. Put those kings away and come back to him. Because what happened with the Israelites? Every time they cried out to him, every time they repented, he delivered them. And he'll do the same thing for you. It's not too late. If you're still breathing, it's not too late to repent, because he will deliver you. God will not forsake his people. And he will deliver you. Whatever your need, please come as we stand and as we sing.